I will be here to answer questions. If you have any now while I'm talking, that's, yes.
The fish.
The fish. Oh, I'm glad you asked about the fish. A few years ago, I had a show at the Jewish Community Center in San Jose, and somebody asked me about the fish. And I had a friend years ago told me that the fish is a symbol of fertility. However, you'll notice that the fish is not cooked. And I said to this person, when asked the question, okay, I'm asking you, what do you think would be more interesting in a painting? An uncooked chicken or an uncooked fish? Hence the fish. And I can't give you any more specific answers to that. I'm not thinking fertility, for instance, in the fashionista. Faye said something very interesting. I hope it's okay for me to share the comments from the provost, from Merrill, one thing that she said.
Well, maybe is Elizabeth here?
Yes.
Right here. There she is. Is that
you, Elizabeth?
Yes.
Oh! Fantastic. Okay. She said, and I won't get rid of her, she said, but she is really subversive. And I have to tell you, my heart was pounding with excitement when I heard you say that. And the reason I say that, as you look at some of the more recent pieces of Judaica, and you'll know by the dates, you will see that the women are no longer just holding the trays of pastry and sitting with the prayer book. They are now holding the males and ready to release them. They are in charge. They have the tefillin wrapped around their fingers. They are wearing the prayer shawls. Yesterday morning, before we hit the road to come over here, the New York Times had a wonderful article about the group of Jewish women who were going to pray at the wall in Jerusalem. And the Orthodox people were spitting on them, throwing chairs at them, and saying things that were very uncomplimentary. I'm not going to say any more. I will let you explore these pieces on your own, and I think you'll understand where I am now. As I've gotten older, I have realized it's okay to say these things. My mother used to say years ago, and I think I finally grew into what she said. She used to say to me, you know what? People are going to talk about you no matter what you say and what you do. So you may as well say what you want to say. And I'm thinking, I'm going to be 74. If not now, when? I don't know how much longer my hand will allow me to do the work. My eyes will allow me to see these things. So I'm going to say it. But the bottom line is still, is it pleasing to me visually and aesthetically? Now, somebody else had a question? Yes.
I was going to ask if all the individuals in your paintings are fiction, or are you influenced by
they are
observing?
My favorite word is imagination. If you come to our house, out on our patio, engraved in the concrete when we added some little piece, I wrote the word imagination. And when our first grandchild was going to daycare, I went with her one day, and I wasn't ready to leave, and we were building with some material they had in the room. And I had a group of kids around me, and I said, oh, wow, let's make this a medieval castle or something. And some little boy came over to the table, and he picked up the box. That's not what you're supposed to do. And I said to him, you know what? We are using our imagination. So no, they are never specific people. Now, I may be somewhere in some of the paintings, but you're never going to see me full face. You may see my hand. You may see the top of a vintage hat because I collect and wear vintage hats all the time. You'll see some of the characters wearing gloves. I also have loads of gloves. I don't wear them, but I use them to embellish purses and jackets and belts and all kinds of things. I'm just very fascinated with vintage things. You'll see pieces of quilts. I also have a very extensive collection of vintage aprons. And this, I would say, the ultimate domestic uniform. My studio is between the laundry room and the kitchen. Before I go to sleep at night, I'm thinking, what am I going to make for dinner for my husband? because he's the only one home. So as untraditional as some of my thoughts may be on the pieces of paper, I am still a woman who was married in 1961. I realized from Betty Friedan, you don't have to be thrilled when you're running the electric broom. It was all okay to say, I really don't like doing this, but we did it nevertheless. Okay, anybody else have a... Yes?
Do you want to say anything about your palette?
I'm sorry, can you...
Do you want to say anything about your palette? I mean, particularly the burnt oranges and the certain of the blues.
I'm sorry.
Your color choice.
My color choice. Well, I can't really say very much about that, except that sometimes it will be the composition will determine what's happening. Now, let's say for instance in this one, in this piece, you see, and this is from one of my Vinta Jacobs was the inspiration for this. You will see just a little tiny slivers of blue as the background that we're seeing through the cracks in the wood. On the big one that's here by David, you'll see we see a lot of blue sky. And again, I mentioned you're going to have to, what I hope you'll do is look at the piece from across the room, see what you see that way, and then say, oh, wow. And you get a look. Look at this. I never saw this. And I hope, maybe for those who live near, you'll come back more than once. Because of this piece, unless I pointed it out to you, maybe you could have seen it 10 times, you may never look through this knot hole. And I'm not, for those of you in the back of the room, I won't even tell you what's in the knot hole because I want you to be surprised. So the color palette, I don't use a lot of purple and pink. I don't know. Sometimes it may appear, it may need it for an accent. I have four big trays with little compartments that I squeeze the color on. I have the reds and the oranges and the blues and the grays and the browns, and then within that thing there may be 20 different colors, and I'm mixing the colors all the time. I'm not a neat painter, and one color, as I say, over the other. I also love the texture and the detail. That's what helps me to tell the stories that I'm making up. Or I should say to suggest the stories, because I'm not telling actual stories. You may look at the piece and say, I don't see that. I see something entirely different. And that's what I'm hoping is going to happen when you look at these things. I'm hoping you'll stand in front of some of them and laugh, because I intend to be funny. And others, I hope they'll be more thought-provoking.
Yes, something else that occurs quite often is wood. And you have an unusual gift, many unusual gifts, but you're unusually gifted in representing the grain of wood. Joan pointed out to me that virtually no artist in watercolor can make a representation that suggests wood, and you do. So could you talk about, you talked about rope, and you talked about fish. Could you talk about wood for a minute?
Okay, in the African American series especially, the wood became very, very important to show exteriors of buildings, fences. When I was doing the Japanese series, the tatami mats, I gave a small piece to a neighbor, one of my special gifts, and she called one day and she said, my husband Reinhardt and I are having an argument. He's an engineer, and he said, now retired engineer, he's sure that you're using a ruler to draw the lines on the tatami mats. And she said, and I said, you're doing it freehand. And I said, Rotrop, you win the bet, okay? You could not be drawing and then dragging the ruler down, because then you would have a certain amount of pigment that gets underneath the ruler and it would be smearing. So I just eyeball it. It's not going to be 100% accurate. I can tell you, I do not drink a lot of caffeine if I'm going to do the wood texture. Now, to me, it's just more interesting. I mean, I could have left this color. But then, because I'm not working that far away from the piece, it's much more exciting for me to say, oh my goodness, I've got to start making wood grain and everything. people used to laugh when I would say, I don't like to knit because I haven't got the patience to work with a pattern. But I could sit and do 5,000 tiny little lines. When you get home around the corner and you see the pieces from the quilt series, some black and white pieces, you'll see what I'm talking about. So it just gives me, I didn't know that other people are doing that. I never, because I'm isolated in my studio. I don't go to workshops, and I don't work with classes with other people. I lead a very quiet life. I remember once years ago, my mom said to me, you don't play bridge, and you don't play mahjong, you don't play cards. What are you going to do with your life? And I can tell you, this is what I'm doing with my life, good, bad, or otherwise. Yeah.
So at what point in your art making did you are a very prolific artist. Was there a turning point when you really focused on, you know, your prolific nature, or did it develop over time in your art making?
No, I always worked. When I had our first child, Barry, I worked, and then I got pregnant with our second. And my husband's aunt said to me, oh, you'll never work. So that's going to be it. You'll never be able to work anymore because now you have two kids. Then we had a third child, our son, and the same aunt who lives in Chicago, who's now almost 90. Oh, forget it. You're never going to work. And I kept saying, this is like throwing the gauntlet in my face. Don't tell me I can't do it. I also want to mention something because I did bring in something else. I don't know if some of you will have time to see it. There's a black book binder on the table where Joan is sitting. One of the things that I think is very important is giving to your community. You cannot only take, you've got to give. Years ago, the gentleman who was the rabbi in our synagogue, I had a conversation with him and I said, you know, I'm really frustrated because I keep getting these phone calls from organizations in town. Would you sit on this committee and that committee? And it would be to decide if they should serve egg salad or tuna salad. And I said, you know, that's really not my thing. Now, of course, I don't have to worry about that. Nobody is going to call me because I don't use a computer. And they only want committee people who can connect with a computer. And he said to me, and I have to paraphrase, he said, there's a quotation in the Talmud, if you have a special talent or a special gift and you don't use it all the time and bring it to fruition, it's the same thing as committing a sin. And I decided right then and there, I did not want the label sinner to be appearing on my frontispiece. And so over the years, that's what you'll see in the book, samples of different things, pieces of work where I was able to use my images for various activities in the community. And I think it's very, very important. I know Faye is going to talk to, I think, the students from Hillel, and I'm sure this is part of the message that they get when they get together. Yes?
I noticed in some of the paintings...
You're going to have to speak.
Oh, okay. I noticed that in some paintings there's no eyes, and I'm like very close, so I was wondering if there's any reason behind that.
No, there's no particular reason. I may feel that it's, I don't want the character staring out from the painting. You're also going to notice, if you look here at some of these, the older things, the first piece that was the headpiece for White Butterfly, and that was the title of that piece, she's got great big sunglasses on, and she's got Japanese hair ornaments, but she also has pieces of celery sticking out of her hair because she's the transition piece. And in the sunglasses, you see reflected yet another story. Also, when I was looking over my archives last week, I remembered I had done a whole series of people wearing masks, Japanese women holding fans. I have never done any pieces with nude figures. I have just not found that all exciting. I'm trying to think that I missed. I'm sure I didn't miss. No, I don't think so. I guess I didn't bring it in. When I took the American couple out from the quilts and put them on the tatami mats, you saw heads of people, just the top of the head. And I had a show in San Jose years ago. And one of the galleries has since closed, and I had some people who came up and said, well, is that supposed to be two men, two women, or a man and a woman, because all you could see was the top of the head. And I said, I'm going to let you make your own story. And you would see kimonos opening, but you'd see, you wouldn't see the body in the front, you'd see the back of the kimono. You'd see the red sash sometimes tumbling down. Something was going to happen next. We didn't know what specifically. Let's each make up our own story. I always thought it's much more interesting. Yes?
How do you decide on the size of a piece and where it's going to end, like the confines? Because I noticed some of them, like, kind of, they're not straight edges. They kind of...
That's the paper. This is the one that's the edge. Excuse me, this is the edge of the paper. Now, sometimes I use watercolor paper, and sometimes I use Arches paper that's sort of a creamy color, and it's used for printmaking, not for watercolor, and it absorbs the color differently. So sometimes I have to paint two or three times to get the level of color that I want. And other times, the first go-around will give it to me. Now, how do I decide the size? Sometimes I'll walk into the studio with a big sheet of paper. Okay, I'm going to cut this big sheet of paper into five strips. Now, what kind of images can I create where they're going to look like Japanese pillar prints, where they're going to be long and skinny? This was probably one of those pieces that was from an odds and end of a piece of watercolor. And I didn't need anything wider to give me the space that I needed to work that composition. So it's a killer when you want to frame things, because I can't use this frame, won't fit this piece. So it's hard for me to swap out frames if I'm getting ready for a show, because they're not regular sizes. Yes?
I haven't seen all the pictures yet, but...
I'm sorry, I can't hear.
I haven't seen all the pictures yet, yes. But it seems that the pictures reflect women's worlds,
yes.
A woman's world,
yes.
And the women's items, women's props, scissors and aprons, it seems.
Yes.
And the men appear in couples. So I was interested in hearing, do you consider the world to be a man's world and a woman's world?
On her picnic basket, and she's got a big fork in her hand, and we don't know what's in the basket and what she's going to do. But I tell you, that broke my heart. Do I think it's a world where women have equality in everything? I think if we quietly ask every woman in this room to write something on a little piece of paper, you would not get as many yeses as you would noes. We're hoping that's going to change. People like my daughter, who's in the business world and making an effort to see that we don't talk about what the gender is with regard to the job. People like Faye, with her psychology students, and the other people here from the university, who's to say that I can't do it as well as they can do it? So I'm not sure if that answers your question, but it's the show really was things from my view. I used to think, and now of course with technology, somebody's probably done this, if we took women from all over the world who didn't speak the same language, and we created a huge yurt, and you put us all in this yurt, and we had some kind of a little machine that we could use to communicate with one another. We have so many shared experiences by virtue of what our bodies are, what we've done with them, what nature has assigned to us, we've chosen to fulfill these roles or not. And there's just a universality here. Now, there are many men who have become nurturers, and many men who have assumed domestic roles. The world is an entirely different place now than when I got married in 1961. Stay-at-home dads, nobody ever heard of that years ago. And at this point, I can't say that I'm going to change my point of view too much, because that article about the women at the wall who were being hit with the stones and the chairs, that article is tucked in the things that I've had to come over the hill, because I'm not through with that subject matter yet. There's a piece The ayin, A-Y-I-N, is usually silent. That piece will get you into that subject matter. I'll tell you, one of my favorite publications is Lilith Magazine, which comes out, and I see heads nodding, a few times a year. And they've done some wonderful exposés on things that prominent males have done that we don't want to talk about and we don't like to acknowledge, but I'm sorry, it's there, it's happening. Did I ever burn my brassiere? No. But I raised two daughters and a son. I made sure that my son understood it was okay to cry. It's okay to feel bad. It's okay if you've hurt somebody's feelings to say I'm sorry. And to tell our two daughters, you go for it. You know, you don't have, just because you're wearing a skirt, that doesn't mean that you can't do it or you aren't just smart. Our synagogue was the first one in Northern California that had young girls at the age of 13, when they were going through their bat mitzvah, conducting the entire 3-hour service. And there were plenty of boys in the class that I knew couldn't do it and chose not to because they just weren't as mature and they weren't ready for it. Yeah.
Honey, do you have any anything to say about what you might be doing in the future?
No. Actually, I am working on a piece. Before I go on a vacation, there is nothing worse, as I mentioned before, than coming home to the blank piece of paper. Because sometimes I'll take a little book with me and I'll have all these little pieces of paper. I didn't bring in, I have books and books and books in my studio. They are not sketchbooks. They are books where I have scraps of paper and funny things I might have cut out from the newspaper. One comes to mind right away. Remember, Mona Shevitz was having a cooking competition, and I thought, oh, that could be a whole series unto itself. And sometimes, if you're with me socially, you've probably heard me say, oh, you may find yourself in one of my paintings, or someday this incident is going to be in one of the paintings.
So you leave your system open to serendipity or whatever.
Absolutely,
it is,
absolutely. I'm working on a piece now. Yeah. The piece that's on my table now is a watercolor. We are looking down. The figure is an African American woman. All you see are her two large hands. And she has a head wrap on, and there's a feather, it's stuck in her head wrap, and she's got a feather under her fingers, and she's got a blank, there's like a blank piece of paper that's sort of folded in the middle, and there she's got one, there's a feather line on the page that's sharpened at the end like a quill, and if you look very carefully, very faintly, you can see a thin red line. And then behind this piece of paper is what looks like it might be a ledger, whether it belonged to a slave owner. I don't know where this came from. And what simulates writing, oh, people have asked me, is this really Hebrew writing on the tiny little thing? Is this really Japanese? I don't write Hebrew and I don't know how to write Japanese, so I'll tell you again, it's from my imagination. And the title of that piece, I think, is going to be Her Secret. Now, I mentioned earlier, you will see in almost every one of the African-American pieces, books, knowledge, information, education, learning. All of this is, I think, absolutely one of the most important things. So, I don't know for sure what her secret is, but she's got the quill, which is a writing instrument, ready to go. This museum in San Francisco a couple years ago had a young woman who wrote a Torah. And you could go and watch her, you could see her. They had a fabulous exhibit. And I cut out the article from the Chronicle one morning, and the piece that was created, we didn't pick it for the show. A good quill day. She had to make her own quills out of feathers. I think they were turkey quills. And you see the woman in traditional dress and then her arms waving. But in the background, you see a gray shadow that looks like a Hasidic figure. But it's in the background. There's no lines, there's no colors, there's no shape. And she's got the quill in her hand.
One last question from Elizabeth.
So, I'm glad to hear you talking again about the function of text.
You
have to speak up.
So I was glad to hear you speaking again about the function of text in your images and lettering and so on, and also a little bit startled to hear you say that you don't write Hebrew, since in a number of the Jewish series pictures, the letters that seem most prominent are Aleph Shin, which, if my spelling is right, means fire. So you just talked about not having burned your braziers during that. Ish here and ish there and prominent olive and shin.
You can't, you know what? And they were picked strictly for their shapes. Mm-hmm. That's what I've said over the years. I hope I'm not swearing. I hope I'm not saying anything inappropriate. Heaven only knows the writing that looks like Japanese writing for sure, and that isn't going to say anything. If you look carefully, that probably looks like tying in Hebrew letters. So, that's great. I love that.
I have to check with my mother. That is the right spelling for it.
It is?
Yeah. Okay.
But there are a lot of
letters. That means fire?
Fire.
Okay, I don't remember that. I was the illustrator along with the printer. Yiddish alphabet book, which came out in 1979. You could probably still find a copy online, a used copy, and then it went into second printing. And people used to ask me, do you speak Yiddish? And I said, no, I draw Yiddish.
So I'm going to jump up right now because it is 1:30. Bonnie had said before, she said, I can't talk for more than 10 minutes. Yeah, right. But I think she's going to be, we're going to have the 2 to 4, that'll be the opening, but she's not going away in between now and 2. You can talk to her. You can talk to her at any time you want to. You can have her ask you what you see in any picture. But for right now, I think we want to say a huge thank you to both. Chairs out, but if you want, we'll have the chairs outside if you want to enjoy the outside or enjoy the show. And again, our great good luck to have had Bonnie Stone come here to UCSC. So once again,